Okay, I'd like to move now to our discussant part of the program and introduce Maria Fernandez. Dr. Fernandez is associate professor, as you can see, of health promotion and behavioral science at the University of Texas. Has been very involved in working in this field for some time.
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank the two Steves for the invitation to participate, and also, as such, to have a preview of three outstanding papers. I'm going to just highlight quickly some of the key points of each paper, since you just saw those, discuss some cross-cutting themes, issues, and challenges, and recommend some questions for discussion, including the questions that you just saw at the end of each paper presentation, but also a few additional ones. So in the first paper, we saw that the authors provided a framework for understanding multi-level influences and identifying intervention targets, and importantly, provided some definition of key terms. The intent is both to better understand and to influence the interplay of forces at these multiple levels. Paper one also proposed desired measures of success based on the AHRQs and IOM's definition of quality of care across the cancer continuum, and articulated a key research question as we move forward. How do the levels of influence affect each other and the processes of healthcare delivery and health outcomes? In paper two, Jane Zapka and her colleagues presented case studies and hypothetical interventions at different levels. I think this paper does an excellent job in helping us see what an individual experiences, as well as the different levels that influence the quality of their care. They used these cases to illustrate both the complexity and the types of multi-level interventions and identified intervention targets at various levels. And then finally, they discussed challenges in designing studies to determine the impact of different components at different levels. In paper three, the authors did an outstanding review of the literature, looking at articles from cancer control, chronic disease, and the prevention literature, and identified opportunities related to design, analysis, and translation, and especially for interventions that create synergy across the levels and adapt over time. In the paper, they describe four examples and show the potential for how this might be addressed. They conclude that transdisciplinary participatory research can generate knowledge to reduce the cancer burden. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. So now to the cross-cutting issues, themes, and challenges that really were presented in all the papers. First, I think important to point out the opportunities for research on multi-level interventions across the cancer care continuum and why cancer is a good model for evaluating multi-level influences. Part of the reason, and we've heard a lot about this, is that it includes several types of care, as well as transitions between the types of care from prevention through end of life. And as such, it lets us look at contextual influences at these different stages. So the types of care, screening, diagnosis, and treatment include process steps, as Steve talked about, within each of these stages of care, and individuals across the levels that influence and interact in different ways depending on where the person is in that stage of care. So the challenge, and I believe this is brought up in paper three, is to design interventions that improve care for patients at different points across the continuum. So they may be very different for each individual patient, yet are sustainable and flexible and generalizable enough to impact population groups. So some of the gaps, and a lot of this came from paper three in the literature review, was across the cancer control continuum, most multi-level interventions have focused on prevention, screening, and end of life, but seldom on diagnosis, treatment, and surveillance. There's few detailed reports of how multi-level interventions have been implemented and how they've become successful or unsuccessful. And part of the reason for this that's highlighted in the paper may be issues in funding, and this is an important challenge that I hope you'll discuss at your tables. How do we fund these types of interventions and intervention research? And also publication bias is another issue that was brought up in the paper. Most of empirical reports are RCTs, and we may need to move beyond this. Another important gap is that theories, models, and interventions are not well integrated in reports and studies. Other gaps include that while many studies use ecological systems and complexity models, few of them describe how they've applied these theory to inform interventions, and very few measured impacts at multiple levels. Again, you heard that while multi-level interventions are contextual, context is inadequately reported. There's more need for measuring these effects. There's no clear guidance on the types of intervention strategies at various levels. And probably most importantly is while we all think that this is a good idea and there's some evidence that it might work, effectiveness of multi-level interventions is not yet evidence-based. I wanted to talk a little bit about theory because theory is sort of mentioned across the papers. And in particular, although I think Steve and others point out that there really isn't a unifying theory that can help answer all the questions we have as we try to understand multi-level influences and intervene. There are some theories that can be helpful. The social cognitive theory, for example, informs how individuals and their social and built environment interact through a concept called reciprocal determinism. Organizational development theories and organization theories illustrate how organizations innovate by establishing goals, programs, and ideas. Network theories describes webs of linkages between organizations. And the theory of complex adaptive systems suggests that effects travel in multiple directions, and it's not necessarily linear or hierarchical. The practical integrated systems model, or PRISM, combines elements of both organizational theory and partnership models, and then REAIM helps us understand targets and considerations for increasing reach and implementation and maintenance. In Steve's paper, he also mentions how precede-proceed may be useful in planning interventions, multi-level interventions, and I would also add that intervention mapping may also be useful in planning as well because it helps us consider individuals and their behaviors at multiple stages, and I'll talk just a little bit about that in a minute. So essentially, though, no single theory has been developed to explain complex relationships between contextual factors and behaviors of those providing or seeking care. It's an important gap. Across the papers, they identify design and analysis challenges, including the fact that while the current paradigm in which level-specific theories drive level-specific interventions and measures is inadequate, and what's needed is measurement across levels and statistical methods that consider interdependence of outcomes. I think it was in paper 3 that Zapka and colleagues pointed out that like multifaceted interventions, where we know they work, but we're not exactly sure what part of that intervention worked, it may not be possible to determine which elements or levels of multi-level interventions are the most important or effective, and that's something that we should consider as we begin to design multi-level intervention research studies. Ultimately, again, studies are needed to test whether multi-level interventions have a greater effect than intensive interventions at a single level, and cost-effectiveness also should be a consideration. Some of the opportunities, I'll go through this quickly because I believe that Kurt covered a lot of this. Dynamic adaptive designs that evolve over time are promising. Multi-level statistical methods and models that allow measurement and comparison at different levels. And the use of multi-method approaches, both qualitative and quantitative methods, is promising, as well as complex systems and dynamic simulation modeling. I think importantly, and this was highlighted in a couple of the papers, training, research partnerships need to be more transdisciplinary, inclusive, democratic, and participatory. And I think that much of what we know about participatory planning in the community setting can be applied to planning interventions at multiple levels. And then lastly, as a sort of a cross-cutting issue, an observation, I think that there's a lot of overlap between multi-level intervention research and dissemination and implementation research, and some of these have been pointed out, and it includes the observation that discovery of improvements in isolated steps of care, that reductionist approach that Steve talked about, doesn't necessarily lead to their incorporation of care. And part of that reason is because when you try to incorporate interventions that have been developed in tightly controlled settings, they may lead to unexpected results because context wasn't taken into consideration. So conceptual models and frameworks that have been used and suggested for informing research on multilevel interventions are also used for dissemination and implementation research, and those include like re-aim, like I mentioned. However, I would like to point out that I think that there's some fundamental differences between multilevel intervention research and dissemination and implementation research. While some of the issues like adaptation and fidelity are important in both, I think that when we're considering making changes at particular levels in multi-level interventions, and if you think about organizational levels, providers, that those behaviors and activities may be quite different than those behaviors or activities or processes for adopting and implementing interventions. So this is a much longer discussion, but I do think that there's some fundamental differences, although there is overlap. Finally, as a behavioral scientist that's sort of exploring these different models and areas as we consider multi-level interventions, I think that I may disagree a little bit with Arnie about forget everything you learned before, because I think that when you look at these levels, you realize that, yes, there's policy levels and there's organizational and community, but fundamentally there's people in these levels, and there's people that need to make specific changes in order to change their environments. Even policymakers, even directors of clinics, they have to make specific decisions, specific changes in their own behaviors in order to make those changes in the environment. So I think to address the complexity of multi-level influences, we have to develop intervention approaches that ultimately are changing the behavior of people in the environment. I'm not going to read these questions. We'll put them up again afterwards. Is that okay? Some of them you've already heard. And now it's time to talk amongst yourselves.